Gaming has seen a fairly interesting history when it comes to physical peripherals. From the Atari 2600's number pad, to the Nintendo Entertainment System's light guns, all the way to the plethora of plastic housings for the Wii nunchucks and Move controllers, and the rather advanced Thrustmaster racing wheel for the PlayStation 4, video game developers have made no secret about the fact that sometimes basic controllers just aren't quite enough to fully realize the experience they're going for. It's a risky move to tie your game to a bulky controller alternative, as many have fallen by the wayside for one reason or another, but it is a path worth traveling if it really makes sense for the game. Perhaps no collection of games has won that gamble quite as thoroughly as the Guitar Hero and Rock Band games. The miniature guitar-shaped controllers with their colorful buttons and lightweight might give off a bit of a Fisher-Price vibe at first glance, but that didn't stop gamers of all ages and types from at least giving it a try at a friend's house, if not becoming a full-blown addict with several Guitar Hero controllers sitting around their living rooms, dens, and game dungeons for years. The concept couldn't be any more timeless. Playing along with your favorite licensed real songs in a simplified way, either by yourself or with friends, pleasing the virtual crowd to earn your way through the game and unlock the songs. To put it bluntly, Guitar Hero caught fire. At its height, it was culturally iconic worldwide, and once it got hot enough, a very logical extension of Guitar Hero was forged in the fires of its success with the Rock Band series. Here we saw a similar idea, just drawn out to its logical conclusion of including bass lines, drum parts, keyboards, and a vocalist mic. And much like the Guitar Hero guitars, many of these instruments are still found today all over the world. However, many of the peripherals that are still owned today are likely relegated to attics, basements, and storage units. Which brings me to an important question. With a series that had taken the world by storm in such a profound way, by transcending genre and drawing in gamers of all persuasions for so long, how could it be so irrelevant today? Going back a little over a decade, it was 2005. This was the twilight era for the PlayStation 2, Nintendo GameCube, and the original Xbox generation. The DVD-ROM games were still acceptable, but everyone knew more powerful consoles were on the way. It was an interesting time for developers to try new things, as several games were coming out that had pushed these machines to their limits in terms of graphical fidelity and general creativity, the latter of which was surely the priority for Harmonix when they decided to mimic some guitar-playing games that were doing well in Japan arcades, but package the idea in a more universally digestible way. Bringing that concept together with licensed music tracks was well within the wheelhouse of Harmonix, as they already had musical rhythm games under their belt like Frequency and Amplitude. Guitar Hero was a very logical step for them, as it was for gaming as a whole, and Activision agreed, which is why they bought the intellectual property and handed development off to Neversoft, just as this series was really taking off after its second game. As one might expect, this led to the peak and eventual decline of the series. Activision and Neversoft more or less perfected the format of Guitar Hero with the third installment, Legends of Rock. It was not only packed with more songs than the original two, but it would feature compatibility with newfangled wireless controllers, and rock legends Slash and Tom Morello as avatars for the player. The game garnered the acclaim you would imagine, as it brought together everything the original two games did correctly, but with the expanded capabilities, upgraded graphics, and marketing elevation that the deeper pockets of Activision could bring. While the game was largely Neversoft's and Activision's cash cow, Harmonix wasn't completely out of the picture. They had been hard at work on their ultimate vision of expanding the concept to include drums, vocals, and other instruments with Rock Band. With the help of MTV, Rock Band launched around the same time as Guitar Hero 3, and by all means was largely an improvement with the additional instruments and more authentic-looking controllers. Both games were successful in terms of sales and critical reception, but clearly Rock Band had a bit of an edge and more room to grow as a franchise, despite some reports of issues with the launch versions of the guitars and bass drum pedals. Rock Band 2 would largely fix these issues, but played it safe and stuck to minor tweaks tweaks to the format, one of which was streamlining the main tour mode by not separating the single-player tour from the multiplayer one, and instead having one single tour that additional players could drop in and out of at their leisure. This fit much better with the parties and gatherings of friends that the series was clearly made for, and was probably part of the reason why Rock Band 2 did so well despite its conservative approach. Not to be outdone, Guitar Hero World Tour, the fourth game in the main series, aimed to blur the lines between their franchise and Rock Band by branching out into other instruments and vocals themselves. This effort would review well with gaming news outlets and seemed to make sense on paper, but while Activision largely accomplished the goal of imitating Rock Band on a general level, this muddying of the waters would plant a seed of a slow rot for both franchises and the genre as a whole. One person might have Rock Band 2, their friends might have Guitar Hero World Tour, and the subtle differences and dodgy compatibility between each game's peripherals across the different platforms quickly made the entire genre a big mess over the next several years. Trying to get different generations of different games' instruments to work across different systems would sometimes miraculously work out, but usually not entirely. And nothing breaks the mood of a party like troubleshooting electronics. It also didn't help that both rhythm franchises would start churning out games invalidating previous entries at a rate more akin to sports games, which is probably why you can find games in both genres at the bottom of bargain bins everywhere these days. The Guitar Hero and Rock Band franchises would continue to oversaturate and outgrow themselves with ham-fisted sequels and spin-offs, many of which were fine functionally, but it was as if there was nowhere to really go with them anymore, and the DJ Hero games did very little to rejuvenate the genre. 2012's Rock Band Blitz and 2015's Guitar Hero Live were formidable death throes and functionally fine, but paled in comparison to previous entries in terms of sales and cultural impact. The genre was muddled beyond recognition by then, and most of the crowd that played the original games in their heydays were well into their adulthood now, and didn't really have the same type of lifestyle they did in 2006, where it made more sense to have plastic drum sets and guitars laying all over their living rooms. Both Rock Band and Guitar Hero didn't have the audience they used to, on top of the utter chaos they plunged their own genre into, with a plethora of versions of games and instruments. The games just seemed to reach their logical conclusion conceptually. There's really not much you can do in any of the newer games that wasn't already done several different ways in the older games. This is not an uncommon problem for long-running franchises to have, though. Need for Speed and the Madden games struggle with similar issues. The main difference between those games and the Rock Rhythm games being Madden and Need for Speed still sell relatively well, and they show no signs of going away. Why? Because those franchises still have their core audience. Madden players still buy Madden games, and racing fans are likely to pick up the next Need for Speed, Forza, and/or Gran Turismo. The seemingly limitless appeal of Rock Band and Guitar Hero was actually a bit of a time bomb. Once that blew up and the block of teenagers and 20-somethings saw their focus divided more and more by careers, education, and their own children, there was less and less room for the parties and regular gatherings that the games were tied to. This doesn't mean that those franchises couldn't have a future with current and later generations, and it doesn't mean that there aren't still hardcore fans out there that do still have room for those games in their lives. But it does mean that, at least for now, their appeal is limited. That being said, I think it would be a mistake to count them out for good. As rock music itself goes through its own waves of popularity and decline, one could logically suspect that these games are just waiting for the right moment to explode back onto the scene. That's it for this video. If you enjoyed and would like to see more, feel free to hit that subscribe button and hit the notification bell to ensure you'll be notified when new videos go up.